What's up, y'all? I'm Alan Hain, the Lawn Care Nut. Thanks for coming back for yet another week. So it's getting to that point where I can't keep you guys backed off anymore. I know that spring fever has hit an all-time fever pitch. It doesn't matter that there's one more freezing snowstorm on the horizon for you guys up north. You're ready to get out. And so with that, I've got a nice treat for you today. At least I think it's a nice treat. So a lot of you are aware of the lawn coaching that I do over on Patreon. And now this is not an advertisement for that. In fact, I'm pretty sure it's full. I keep it limited to only 50 people on purpose, just so I can make sure that everybody gets full attention. But no, this is related to that, because what happens is, in that coaching program, guys have to send me videos and pictures of their lawns so I can help identify what's going on. We can look at site situations, we can look at different kind of weeds, grass types, all that, and then we can set up a custom plan for them. So in the last week, there's a couple guys I've been talking to, and they actually sent me videos of their lawns as they're coming out of winter time right now. And I got the idea that, you know, if these guys are experiencing these problems with their lawns or these questions right now, probably most of you subscribers up north or in cool season lawn territory, you probably have some of the same questions as well. So I asked these two guys, I'm like, hey, could you let me use these videos and pictures in an upcoming video on the Lawn Care Nut channel as a way to help others? And both of them were like, sure, man, go ahead. And so that's what today's video is. Two examples of cool season lawns and what they look like right now and what some of the signs are that you may be experiencing in your lawn as well. Now, the other thing I'm gonna do is provide an update of my lawn here all the way around, but I'm gonna do that towards the end of the video. So right now, let's go into the studio and let's get some lawn tips. Okay, so our first lawn that we're gonna look at, this is Patrick, and he is in Northern Illinois. So let's take a look at the video that he sent me, and let's take a look at what he's dealing with.
But this is basically it. Last summer, it was looking really bad. I followed some of your advice, and you know, I got looking better. I thickened it up this fall, but it seemed to have thinned out again over the winter season. I don't know if that's normal.
So to start right there, yes, this is very, very normal. The lawn hasn't necessarily thinned out. It's just dried out. It's not vigorous. It's not growing. And so you're just kind of seeing it in its complete kind of, just dormant, just coming out of, you know, waking up phase, and it just doesn't look that good. But this is extremely normal for a lawn coming out of winter. Just wait until you see what this will do when you get some furt on it. Throw her down, baby.
You can see there's some bare spots there. You know, it's just got a lot of overall just kind of really thin areas. I got a lot of trees on my property. I got that big tree right there. I got this big tree.
The other thing that happens is there is, you know, rodents and things that play under there, animals, maybe raccoons, cats, dogs, who knows, and those can also contribute to some of this thinning, as well as any leaves that are left. Again, that's why we tell you to get the leaves up when you can. Leaves piled in can also thin areas down, as well as any foot traffic that may have been on the lawn. I don't think that's the case in this one, but if you have kids that build snowmen on the lawn, things like that, that foot traffic will also cause some of what you're seeing here. And then just in general, as freeze-thaw, snow comes in and melts, it's gonna move things, right? Snow moving off, you know, it does have an effect, just like if you think about the glacial periods of this country where the glaciers came across and they create landscapes, that kind of happens in a micro kind of way in your lawn. That freeze-thaw and that snow moving and that ice moving, it tends to move things, which can kind of make it look like the lawn's thinned out, but it's not. It's just things have been kind of uprooted or upheaved as that snow moves itself off.
And especially in these back two trees in the backyard, I have some problem areas. You know, all this right over here, this was looking really bad last year. Really kind of was like all in over here. I got it to fill in a little bit, but this thing drops a lot. A lot of these little, these leaves drop off in the fall, and I think it kind of just chokes out this lawn.
Yep, you're exactly right. It's an arborvitae, and actually if you take one of those leaves and you crush it up in your hand and smell it, it's a beautiful Christmas tree smell. But those leaves or those needles or whatever they call them on an arborvitae falling will change the pH of the soil, and that can thin the lawn out, as well as there's competition then for water and nutrients and sunlight all at the same time. So it's really tough to grow underneath any kind of evergreen directly. But your fertilizing has gotten the grass to kind of strengthen and move in a little bit, but you're probably never gonna get grass to grow all the way up to the base of it. So in this case, you might wanna expand that bed that's behind it or make a mulch ring or something like that.
See here, I get all this stuff that just piles up in here. It's really hard for me to pick it up with anything. Also this tree over here, you know, I got some really thin areas. I don't even know if we can do anything about this. There doesn't get a lot of sun down here, so I just got pure dirt over there, and it's really thinned out over here. Again, I aerated and added seed this last fall. So I got some growth going, but it just thinned back out over the winter season.
So underneath that big tree, I think that's a silver maple. I would definitely call no joy, which means can't see it happening, it's not gonna happen, gotta back out of it. Just go ahead and make a nice big flower bed there. I put hostas in there. They do really, really well in the shade, especially up where you live. And you know what, they look really cool too. They have different colors, they have variegated and variations. They look really nice. That's what I'd put there.
Same thing, you know. Overall, you know, I think it looks a lot better than when I bought it, following your advice on the videos, but I just like to address these thin areas and get this thing to look nice and thick. That's kind of my goal here. So any help that you could give me would be greatly appreciated. Hopefully you can hear me. It's really windy out here. This is all me.
Just wanted to say, nice edging. I know you haven't edged already this year, but I can see what you did last year already. Looks really good. Tight.
So I got this whole lot over here. It's all me, all the way up to that fence back there. I don't know if you can see it, but that's his property line. So this whole lot is mine. Same thing. We got a little patch over here. I'm not too worried about this. This little patch looks good. I don't know if anything can be done about this. This is just a small little patch, but just really thinned out and dirty.
A big parkway tree like that in a small area, really tough to grow grass, but it can be done there. It's just gonna take a lot of babying. Tough to turn that into a mulching, might look a little strange. So in this case, I really would work hard to get the grass growing, realizing that it's gonna come along a little slower every spring. You may have to seed every single spring in that area. You may also have to condition the soil a little bit because of all the ice that comes off the roads can also affect that. So you've got a perfect storm of tough grass to grow there, but I would definitely try it because that's your parkway out front. And so if you can get it to look good, it'll look pretty stunning around that tree. So overall, this lawn reminds me a lot of the church project lawn that I did a few years ago. I'll link in the description below to my hybrid organic program. It's the main one that most of you guys use. Now, I've given Pat a custom plan. Again, that's part of the coaching, but I can tell you that this lawn right here doesn't have any serious problems that I can see. It's gonna turn super green and it's gonna get nice and thick as soon as we get warm temps and he hits it and he throws her down some good nitrogen. So if your lawn looks like this one, you're in really good shape. Everybody thinks, oh, I got to do all this massive overseeding and massive aeration. No, this is a very, very textbook out of winter northern lawn that's going to look beautiful in just a few short weeks. Pat, you've done a great job so far, and I look forward to seeing your progress. So our next one is Ben in Northeast Ohio.
It's probably a fescue, like you said, and I got a some kind of weed or thistle or something coming in.
So I'll tell you what, bro, that is a tough one. Thistle is horrible. I'll tell you a quick story. I had never seen thistle before. When I first started working for True Green way back in the 1990s, I was doing a lawn evaluation and I didn't know what that was. So I reached down with bare hands. I was gonna pull it up and take it back to the office with me so that way I could get it identified for if I came across it again. And I did. I grabbed that puppy straight on, grabbed it, and pulled up like a handful of razor blades. So don't make that mistake. But as far as those go, I used to get them in my lawn in Northwest Indiana. You can use chemicals on them, but it's really tough. What I usually did is I literally just burned the middle of them out with my propane torch. I never did any videos on it, but I would burn the middle of them out with my propane torch, and that typically kept them under control so the grass could thicken up around them. Or of course, you can dig them out or pull them out. Just remember they got a really long tap root and you need to get as much or all of that as possible.
Ready? Let's see what else I can show you. There's no real problem areas in the front, but
your edging's looking tight too. Even after winter, looking good. Dominate with tight edging.
It's kind of patchy. I'm not sure if this is good or bad. I've never really lived where it snowed a lot, so I do have some areas like this where there's some kind of moss or something. There's some clover.
So these thin areas you're seeing, same thing. It's just where snow's moved off or moved on. It's just kind of ripped the turf a little bit. That's gonna fill in no problem pretty quick. I do see you have a few weeds coming in. That's the tough thing we've had this year with those February warm temps and then it's frozen again. The weeds definitely grow through that. That's the thing about weeds, you know, they can grow through extremes that the turf can't. So that's something you're gonna battle all year, and that's why I recommend you get a hand can and just spot spray all year round whenever you see the weeds. Use a little marking blue so you don't double spray and you know what you've hit. I will say though, don't spray weeds if the temperatures are gonna dip much below 50 degrees at night because the weed control won't work because the plant has to be actively growing, and typically below 50 degrees, broadleaf weeds aren't doing much growing, which means the weed control cannot move throughout the plant and do its job, so it can just be wasted.
I think I measured it out. It should be around just under 20,000 square feet, I believe, for the front and backyard combined.
20,000 square feet is a really solid, good-sized lawn. You're going to have a lot of fun with that. By the way, you look just as good here. I don't see any major problems. I don't see anything that's worrying me yet.
I have trees. I didn't do a good job of getting the leaves up. I need to do a better job.
I would get out and do a little bit of raking in some of the matted areas. That goes back for the last one we watched, too. Get out and do a little raking just to get some airflow in there and make sure you get those leaves up. We don't want those causing us any problems in the near future here.
There's some dirt areas. I'm not sure what caused that kind of stuff, but I'd like to get that fixed. Here's some areas where they took trees last year, and I'm not sure if they planted the same grass down or not.
Yeah, a lot of people ask about that. Probably the city used an inexpensive mix, but it should blend okay because they're smart enough to know what the typical grass types are in the area, and they're going to try to match them as best they can. The key will be that it looks like it didn't grow in completely, but I'm sure once you start hitting it with fertilizer, it's going to thicken up just like everything else, and typically that should blend in with a similar color as long as everything gets evenly fertilized. The only challenge you might have is if the soil composition of where the tree was is different than the rest of the lawn, but the hope is that they used fill or backfill of the same variant or same soil type as what's surrounding. And if they did, then fertilizer will blend it all in eventually, probably within 8 to 10 weeks at the longest.
Here's kind of the dividing line. Some straw there still. I have all the way over there underneath those pine trees by the road. Here's some more of that kind of dirt patch. This grass looks pretty good over here. Then there's like other stuff mixed in too. I don't know if those are weeds or whatnot. Here's the backyard. We have this thick. This has got to be something different. It's real big blades.
Hard to tell from the video, but I think this could be clumping tall fescue, but it's not really too much to be concerned about now because that area that you're in also looks like you got some sort of evergreen that's dropping a lot of stuff too. So you're gonna have multiple challenges there. I would just work on keeping it fertilized properly, keeping it irrigated, trying to keep up those pine needles or whatever that is there, and see what happens on its own. If you're using pre-emergence, which you are in our custom plan, that should keep the tall fescue clumps in the future from being any worse, and then we can deal with what's there as we move forward. But I think we got other things that we should be concerned about right now, and not necessarily those.
Over here, this is where the grass is like kinda patchy and dead. I feel like maybe somebody laid some different kind of grass seed over here, because there's some different little tufts and thick kind of dead stuff back here.
So just so you guys know, Ben hasn't been in the house very long, so he doesn't have a lot of historical knowledge about this lawn. But I can tell you, Ben, that what you were just putting your hands in is dog pee. You can notice that all the way around the edges of the concrete patio is where all these dead spots are. And what that is, and I didn't know this when I saw the video, but I asked him if he had a dog and he says he does, and she's apparently pretty big, is the dog comes out during the winter, right? It's cold, it doesn't like the cold. So it goes right out the edge of the patio, it goes to the bathroom, and it comes back in. And it does that all winter long. And now when the snow melts, what you see is literally dead grass.
That's my chickens. Like this. Everything else looks okay except for all these little dead patches. There's a little bit of snow on the ground still yet, but it's kind of bumpy, and I'm not really sure what I'm looking at or what I'm trying to do. So here's a pile of something, different kind of grass.
That for sure is a tall fescue clump, but again, I don't see that many that I'm super concerned about it right now. If you want to dig them out as you see them, go ahead, but I'm just not super concerned about it. I think we need to address what we're going to do with the dog first, which a lot of people ask me about this, you know, all right, so how do I cure this dog urine thing? Well, there are like pills and things you can give to your dogs. I don't even know if they work. I'm not really a fan of giving my dog a pill to try to alter its natural state of elimination, so I wouldn't really be into that, but But typically what you got to do is you can keep the area well fertilized. That'll help keep things going, because what's going to happen is now that you see that that's dead, when you get to the summer where the dog pees, some of the areas will turn dark green because it'll have the opposite effect and it'll act like a fertilizer. So you got to kind of determine, can you train the dog to go into a corner or onto a peephole or somewhere outside of the lawn? That's really the only way to cure massive dog urine problems like this, is to just train the dog to pee somewhere that's not a lawn area. I wish I had a better answer for you. You could go behind the dog and water in right behind when the dog pees, but man, you'd have to be out there like 3-4, 10 times a day. I don't know how many times they go, but you'd have to always be behind them, always watering it in. That's just not something that's going to happen. So the key here is, if train the dog to try to go somewhere else, keep the lawn, well irrigated either way, and then keep the lawn well fertilized to help keep things evened out as best as you can. It's going to be a losing battle, like I said, but it's a battle worth fighting. Try to train the dog. So that's kind of the end of that one. I just wanted you guys to mostly see the dog urine spots. This lawn here, though, is going to look really good, really fast. Again, if we could take care of the dog thing. All he needs is some good fertilizer. I am recommending for both lawns aeration in the fall, but not here in the spring. As far as what feels bumpy, I think that once the grass just thickens itself back up, that'll even out some of those bumps. I think when you walk across sometimes, you're actually feeling the tufts where the grass is, kind of still rooted in and some of the areas are thin. But once it thickens itself up all the way across, it should give you a little bit more even feel underfoot. So hopefully that's been helpful to you guys. Now, let's go back outside in my lawn and let's get an update of my St. Augustine grow and my Bermuda grass. All right, here we are, update. Do you think I'm dominating? I would say that while I'm not perfect, I am definitely dominating. So you can see the St. Augustine, this is the bitter blue, grew in mostly really well all in through here. We got a really nice stand with a beautiful color. However, the domination strip has suffered greatly. Just didn't get enough water all the way through because it is a little bit outside of my irrigation zone probably, so domination strip didn't really work, and we got Bermuda invading as well. Now, I've been working on this pretty hard all during the winter when it's really in a very slow growth phase. I've been watering a lot. I've been fertilizing the heck out of it, really seeing how much growth I could get out of this thing. And it's really started to take off now the temperatures are getting warmer. Now, what this is over the winter, this is where some Bermuda invaded. I hit it with glyphosate. I had this idea that I was gonna glyphosate and sod and everything, but I just got tired of putting all this chemical down all the time. I know you guys get on me about it all the time. It's just too much. So that's kind of where we're at right now. Also, I know that these edges are a little dirty. I haven't cleaned these up in a couple weeks. Anyway, over here we go. So we got really good growth again here, looking good. Now, this is where the palmetto starts. And this is also where the doveweed was the worst. This section right here and just up over there is where the doveweed was the worst overall. So you'll see we have Bermuda that's invaded here. This spot here again, this is where I was messing with some glyphosate in the winter. All of this in here, the St. Augustine is doing well, but it's got a lot of Bermuda that's also invaded. But you can see, I mean, look at the pretty color though. As we walk up here, this is all Bermuda invaded in through here, just tons of it. I mean, I must have just not killed it all when I did the original, glyphosate apt before I plugged. This stuff, even small remnants of it that remain can become, really take over in just a few months, and that's what you're seeing here. Coming around here, this is where the doveweed was the worst, and it's also where the Bermuda came in the worst. So what I had done is, again, I hit this with glyphosate at one point in the winter when I was thinking about doing some different things, but I've already explained I got kind of tired of that whole chemical approach. But this is also where the doveweed was the worst, and so we don't have really hardly any good grass in through here. Of course, you can see it's trying. Look at that. I mean, it's not messing around. It's coming across. It's marching in. So this here was the original patch of St. Augustine that was here that I left, and it's expanded greatly just on its own. It was very small, and now it's really moved out. So that's kind of nice that the existing St. Augustine that I did save has started to spread nicely. And then as we get to this part of the lawn, this is where I had the most success. There's hardly any Bermuda that's invaded over here, and the St. Augustine didn't get nailed with the doveweed as hard, so the St. Augustine is looking pretty good over here. I mean, I've got what I would hesitate to call a proper lawn over through here. Right there, a Bermuda patch coming in. But all the rest of this, although a little bit thin, this is all St. Augustine in here. This is the palmetto, and it's in the shade of this oak tree. So it's got some thickening to do, but overall, it's all grass here. This is all St. Augustine. And any of these brown spots you see, these are dead weeds from when I sprayed with the blindside last week. So in a couple weeks, I'll be making an announcement telling you about some drastic measures that I'm gonna need to take here in order to start dominating again in the way that, you know, I'm used to and the way that you guys are used to me dominating. So stay tuned for that. And then here is a Bermuda grow. Now this is, you guys remember last week when I mowed it down to 1 inch that it turned a little brown, and I told you, you know, that's what happens when you use a rotary mower on Bermuda and you get it lower. It's just gonna happen. It's gonna get this kind of brownish cast to it, but I told you to grow back and it did. Look at that nice dark green color out here a little bit. I'm discovering that my irrigation system just does not cover this entire edge. It's really what it's about, but you can see the color here overall is just gorgeous. And once again I am dominating over here. It's not quite as beautiful of a line. And after all, it is an alleyway or an easement, but still dominating. Check it out from way back here. So there you go, there's the update from here in Florida. With that, I hope that this tip has been helpful to you. Happy weekend, happy Sunday, almost happy spring. I'm Alan Hayne, the Lawn Care Nut. Thanks for watching, and as always, I'll see you in the lawn.